Can we switch? I'm better on that side. Okay. When I have a choice, I always choose the right. Okay.
I'm sure you do.
My favorite line about being a Christian college president is attributed to David Davenport, the former president of Pepperdine. I don't know if this is true or not, but he is supposed to have said, he knew it was time to get in a different line of work when he had this dream that he was in a meeting and he woke up and he was. So congratulations, Mike. I hope it's all that and more. I probably should say a word about why Kent and I are doing this the hard way. It's obviously a lot easier for one person to prepare a lesson and the other person to prepare a lesson and then one guy give his and the other one give his rather than going to do what we're going to try to do, which is kind of preach it together. But there's a couple of good reasons for doing it this way. One is, it's one of the great joys of my life to admire the work of my former students, but it is so sweet when you actually get to do something together. So I'll admit that part is self-indulgent. And by the way, we've got a strong team here. When you put our accomplishments together, we have met the president. We have been on Time Magazine.
Don't forget Congress.
Do what?
Don't forget Congress.
Congress. I didn't count that as one of our accomplishments. But anyway. But we wouldn't be doing it this way if we didn't think this was our best chance to get done what we want to do. I'm not going to lie to you, we haven't spent 20 hours together preparing this. That is never going to happen. But we've spent several hours talking about it. And I think we both found the conversation so rich that we thought the best thing to do is to try to include you in the conversation. And you can kind of hear what we're talking about, and we'll see what that leads you to talk about in these passages. Now, the obstacles we're facing tonight are substantial. First of all, we have a big chunk of text. If you go all the way through 6 through 11, and we're not going to begin to try to do all that. We don't have the time to do it, and besides that, time is not the only factor. There are parts in there that we have no idea about. That's what those exegetical classes today were for, to straighten all of that out. And the other obstacle is we don't have the two crucial texts in the middle of Revelation 5:6 and 13:18 as part of our text, and so it's going to kind of be sitting there by itself. And I think all the speakers have the same general ideas about Revelation. But okay, so we got some obstacles, but we also feel like we have a text that is rich in getting us to reflect on the God that Jesus knows. Okay, so Kent, why should we care about these weird, bizarre texts?
Well, we should care because it matters. We're gonna talk about and wrestle with some difficult questions tonight. In troubling times, we often wrestle with the question, why? If the trouble has come to us, we say, why me? Or if it's come to someone we love, we say, why them? Or if we experience what the airline industry calls a near miss, sometimes we still ask, why not me? Why did 11,200 other people die while I get to live? And these are real and timely questions in our world today. It doesn't take far, it doesn't take long to look around and see things like Ebola and Syria and Yemen and Nepal and Charleston. And these are real questions. But as we wrestle with these questions, I think it's very important that we humbly confess something. I think it's important that we confess that we do not have all the answers. We don't have all the answers, and neither does anyone else. I think we do a disservice to the world when we pretend that we have all the answers, when we pretend we know why, that we know the secret that's hidden from the rest of humanity. But does this mean that we should just blow off these hard questions because we don't know why? Or maybe that it doesn't matter what we say? And I think we can echo the words of Paul to that question and say, by no means. It absolutely matters how we talk about these hard questions, because our answers say something about our God and our belief about Him. And what we say about God matters. I think we look at the friends of Job and we see very clearly that what we say about God matters.
So this text opens with, I watched as the Lamb opened the first of the seven seals. Then I heard one of the four living creatures say in a voice like thunder, come. I looked, and there before me was a white horse. Its rider held a bow, and he was given a crown, and he rode out as a conqueror bent on conquest. When the Lamb opened the second seal, I heard the second living creature say, come. Then another horse came out, a fiery red one. Its rider was given power to take peace from the earth and to make men slay each other. To him was given a large sword. Then the Lamb opened the third seal. I heard the third living creature say, come. I looked, and there before me was a black horse. Its rider was holding a pair of scales in his hand. And then I heard what sounded like a voice among the four living creatures saying, a quart of wheat for a day's wages and three quarts of barley for a day's wages, and do not damage the oil and the wine. When the Lamb opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the four living creatures say, come. I looked, and there before me was a pale horse. Its rider was named Death, and Hades was following close behind him. They were given power over a fourth of the earth to kill by sword, famine, and plague, and by the wild beasts of the sea. I occasionally say to my students, I'm going to tell you your future. You're going to get sick, you're going to get old, and you're going to die. If you're lucky. If you're unlucky, you'll get hit by a bus before any of that happens. And in this text, the writer of Revelation gives us a glimpse into the future and says, this is what you can expect. Famine and disease and death. Ecological disaster, biological disaster, social disaster. This is what you can expect. War. I have a rule for my preaching students when we're preaching a text like this, and that is hold people down until they start to gurgle. And we have got to be absolutely clear-eyed about the brokenness and suffering of the world and our ineffective attempts to fix it. One attempt after another, the age of reason, psychology, or the most recent attempt, technology, which is certainly going to solve all our problems. And I'm not anti-technology. Kent wouldn't be standing here if it wasn't for technology. You can chalk me up as one who's grateful for technology. went to my parents' house one time. They were living in Missouri. They had one of those ice storms, knocked all the power out. And I thought, well, this is cool. They had a stove that that worked on wood, and we had gas heat, and so we could cook, and we could be warm. And I thought, no TV. We can read. We can be meditative. This is cool. And then my dad, who is a party pooper, says, you know how we get water, don't you? I said, no. And he says, out of a well. He says, how do you think that gets up here? Electricity? Yeah. You mean we have no water? Right. So I left. I don't mind being a monk, but I want to be one that flushes. Chalk me up as one who is grateful for technology. But I don't know if you've noticed, it hasn't solved the problems that so afflict us. And in fact, it seems to be a form of human pretension that we're one invention, one insight away from solving our problems. So, Ken, how do we think about this? You were telling a story earlier. Are we just cursed? How do you think about you've got a unique perspective on this.
Living in Liberia, you get to learn some unique views on life and the world. Let me tell you a little bit about the explanation for the Ebola outbreak that was ravaging West Africa a year ago and is still ravaging West Africa today as we speak. You see, there was a woman who stole a goat from a family. So that family put a curse on that woman, and she died, and then some of her family members died, and then people around them started dying. And so began the Ebola outbreak. So one of the common beliefs about what was behind all of this was that it started with one person who cursed another. And so it wasn't due to a virus that was being transmitted in body fluids from one sick person to one healthy person. It was a curse. Well, I would wager that a lot of you in this room today would not fully buy into that perspective. But there I was working in this mission hospital with other healthcare professionals, my Liberian colleagues. And in the early days of this outbreak, I found myself in the emergency room talking with some of the nurses. And one of the nurses asked me very directly, she said, is this Ebola thing, do you believe it's because of a curse? Now her question was important because it wasn't a trivial question. So I thought about it before I answered. And my answer was, yes and no. Do I think the Ebola outbreak is because this family's grandmother stole a goat and that's what started all of this? No. But is Ebola due to a curse? Yes. Just like is HIV and pneumonia and diabetes. Because we live in a cursed world. We live in a world that is cursed because of the sin of humankind. And God told us in the beginning we would face cursed lives and difficulty and disease and death because of the curse of sin. and we see the effects of this curse in every aspect of our lives, every aspect of the world. We see it in sickness and death and broken relationships and war and terrorism and racism and oppression. But we serve a God who has promised to set all things right. But when we look around, we see a world full of chaos. And so we ask the question that the souls of the martyrs under the altar in our text ask when we say, "How long, O sovereign Lord? How long will you let this go on? How long before you set things right?" Ebola has been ravaging West Africa for a year and a half. How long, God, before you set things right? And I think that is another hard question that we need to wrestle with.
Yeah, I wonder if part of that has to do with trying to deal with a God who has no sense of time. God, it's been 1,000 years. Oh, sorry, I was just having a cup of tea. How long? And in this text, the evil escalates from chapter 7 to 8 and 9. Early on, a fourth of the people are affected, then a third of the people who are affected. And by the way, if you're not good at fractions, a third is more than a fourth. And in the midst of all that, of this incredible brokenness, war, suffering, cursed world, there is a second question. And that question is this: in this kind of world, who can stand? As Chris Seidman talked about last night, we always hear things out of our own context. And you've got sort of a unique context now. Does the Bible sound any different to you than it did before?
There are passages that I read now that I think, have I ever read that before? I mean, I know I did because I took Corinthian letters with Wendell Willis. I know I read the whole thing. But I think there are experiences we have in life sometimes that help us realize that this ancient holy text is more than old words on a page. And when I read 2 Corinthians chapter 1, I feel like I could have written it. I don't think I ever felt that way before Ebola. But this is a passage that I could have written to our supporters as I was laying in Emory Hospital recovering. "We think you ought to know, dear brothers and sisters, about the trouble we went through in the province of Asia or West Africa. We were crushed and overwhelmed beyond our ability to endure, and we thought we would never live through it. In fact, we expected to die. But as a result, we stopped relying on ourselves, and we learned to rely only on God who raises the dead. And he did rescue us from mortal danger, and he will rescue us again. We have placed our confidence in him, and he will continue to rescue us. And you are helping us by praying for us. Then many people will give thanks because God has graciously answered so many prayers for our safety."
And that's important because the text that we're assigned tonight ends with a discussion of faithful witnesses. And so I want to tee the ball up for Kent and let him swing away at it, because his context and experience has allowed him to see what it means to be a faithful witness in a way that few have. And if you weren't gurgling earlier, you will be in a minute, because chapter 11 is the absolute low point of the book. I was given a reed like a measuring rod and was told, go and measure the temple of God and the altar and count the worshipers there, but exclude the outer court. Do not measure it, because it has been given to the Gentiles. They will trample on the holy city for 42 months, and I will give power to my two witnesses, and they will prophesy for 1,260 days, clothed in sackcloth. By the way, that 1,260 days is very significant. These are the two olive trees and the two lampstands that stand before the Lord of the earth. If anyone tries to harm them, fire comes from their mouths and devours their enemies. This is how anyone who wants to harm them must die. These men have power to shut up the sky so that it will not rain during the time they are prophesying. And they have power to turn the waters into blood and to strike the earth with every kind of plague as often as they want. Now, when they have finished their testimony, the beast that comes up from the abyss will attack them and overpower and kill them. Their bodies will lie in the street of the great city, which is figuratively called Sodom in Egypt, where also their Lord was crucified. For 3.5 days, men from every people, tribe, language, and nation will gaze on their bodies and refuse them burial. The inhabitants of the earth will gloat over them and will celebrate by sending each other gifts, because these two prophets had tormented those who live on the earth. And that's the low point, where the two powerful, faithful witness of God are destroyed and their bodies are desecrated. And people celebrate their demise because the prophets are dead. But as often happens in the Bible, there's a but. Verse 11. But after the 3.5 days, a breath of life from God entered them, and they stood on their feet, and terror struck those who saw them. No kidding. Then they heard a loud voice from heaven saying to them, come up here. And they went up to heaven in a cloud while their enemies looked on. At that very hour, there was a severe earthquake and 1/10 of the city collapsed. 7,000 people were killed in the earthquake, and the survivors were terrified and gave glory to the God of heaven. The second woe was past. The third woe was coming. The seventh seal sounded his trumpet, and there were loud voices in heaven which said, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he will reign forever and ever. And the 24 elders who were seated on their thrones before God fell on their faces and worshiped God, saying, we give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, the one who is and who was, because you have taken your great power and have begun to reign. The nations were angry, and your wrath has come. The time has come for judging the dead and for rewarding your servants, the prophets, and your saints, and those who reverence your name, both small and great, and for destroying those who destroy the earth. Then God's temple in heaven was opened, and within his temple was seen the ark of his covenant, and there came flashes of lightning, rumblings, peals of thunder, an earthquake, and a great hailstorm. What do you hear when you read that passage about these witnesses killed and desecrated and then come to life again? What do you hear?
I'll tell you what I don't hear. I don't hear that being a witness means everything's going to be okay in the here and now. I don't hear a witness that gives a superficial hope. What we see in this passage are two witnesses who bear witness in hope in the midst of a world of chaos, a world under a curse. So when all we see around us is chaos and curse, what does it mean to be a witness? Jesus told the apostles, one of the last things he said before ascending to heaven to take his rightful place at the right hand of the Father was, "You will be my witnesses." We are to be witnesses who bear witness in hope in the midst of chaos. And that hope is not a superficial hope that everything will be okay in the here and now, that no bad will befall us. And it's not a trite hope that says, "It's okay, soon you're going to have a mansion in the sky." In the throes of Ebola, a mansion doesn't quite cut it. And as Randy talked about, my context for a new understanding of witness, some may think about the things we mentioned at the very beginning, the president and Congress and press conferences and speaking to large crowds. But I'll tell you, the place that my mind goes when I think about bearing witness is back inside that Ebola treatment unit, covered up in PPE, trying to bring hope to people who are dying. And I have to tell you that my hope did not save anyone's life. The hope to which I bore witness did not make anyone recover. But I'll tell you what ministered to me when I was on the other side of all of that protective gear was a deep hope that God is who He says He is, and that He will do what He's promised to do, which is to set all things right. When I was facing death, the deep hope that ministered to me was to know that nothing in all creation, not even death itself, could separate me from the love of God. In this world of chaos and curse, I think we do a great disservice when our witness is one of a packaged, processed, off-the-shelf hope that says, "Everything's going to be okay." Because people who live in this world of chaos and curse experience very real suffering. And real suffering is not quenched with trite hope. Real suffering is borne up under when it's supported by a deep hope that God is who He says He is, and that He will eventually set things right.
We had a conversation shortly after you were diagnosed, and I've joked about, I hope can't remember much of that conversation, because I said nothing meaningful. What I did was babble. And I was preaching at your church that Sunday, and I said, tell me what you want me to say. And you said, "This is the passage I'm living out of." Now, you remember what you said, right? I hope you don't remember what I said.
Yeah, the thing that came to my mind in that conversation was the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Those three Hebrew boys who were facing execution at the hand of a tyrant for refusing to bow down to an idol. And they said, O king, our God can save us, and he will. But even if he doesn't, we will not bow down to your idol. And in that moment, that was my prayer. God, I know you can save me, but even if you don't, help me to be faithful.
And one last thought. This little song at the end of 11 declares, we give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, the one who is and who was, because you have taken your great power and have begun to reign. Doesn't look like it. How do we think about the fact that God has begun to reign in the midst of our chaotic world?
I think he's begun to reign not in the way we'd expect him to, not through power, not through political majority, not through technology. I think what we see in the book of Revelation is that God has begun to reign, and he's doing it as a slaughtered lamb.
And so I want to jump out of our text for a moment to what I think is the single crucial text to understanding Revelation. And it's the transition from chapter 5, verse 5, to chapter 5, verse 6. And the whole book pivots on this passage. Then one of the elders said to me, "Do not weep. See, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has triumphed. He is able to open the scroll and its seven seals." Then I saw a lamb looking as if it had been slain. The Revelation writer introduces Jesus with the image of the lion, and he immediately abandons it and replaces it with the slaughtered lamb. Because the gospel of Jesus Christ is not that God so loved the world that he would send World War III. The gospel is God so loved the world that he sent his son. This is the gospel. Not by power, not by might, not by political maneuvering, but by relentless, self-giving love, God will set the world aright. And I'm grateful that you've helped us, you and your family, with your lives, to see that a little more clearly. And now we have an answer to the question, who will stand? The one who kneels before the crucified Lamb. Lord, bless you and keep you. Lord, make his face to shine upon you and give you peace. To him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore, world without end. Amen.